Free to start.
Okay. I think I'm on first, aren't I, Sophia?
Yes, Alec, yeah.
So good morning, everybody, or good afternoon, depending on where you are in the world. I'm going to kick off with an introduction to TWI for those of you who are not familiar with this. Who am I on? Right, yes, thank you. Right. So TWI is a research and technology organisation based in the UK. We were established in 1946, so we've actually been around for 75 years now. Our structure is such that we're owned by industry, who join TWI, companies join TWI as industrial members, and we work on behalf of those companies. And pretty much any company can choose to join as a member, so we can work on behalf of industry on a global basis. We are non-profit distributing, so the money that we generate from undertaking project work comes from our members and is reinvested back into technology on behalf of our members. We are global, so although we're headquartered in the UK, we have sites at certain other places around the world, notably India and Malaysia, and we have members with a fairly wide global reach. Most industrialized countries will have a member within them somewhere, and our total is over 530, so there's quite a wide global reach. Our purpose, our mission, is to provide our industrial members with authoritative and impartial expert advice, know-how and safety assurance through engineering materials and joining technologies. Bit of a mouthful, but the key point is that we are there to work on behalf of and to serve our members with the knowledge that they need. So that breaks down across sort of three main areas of technology. So one of those is around advanced manufacturing. So there's a wide range of joining technologies where we have expertise, many of them welding based, but additionally some non-welding processes such as adhesive joining. We also have within the welding technologies polymer welding. So it's a broad range in terms of materials. It's everything from ferrous alloys, conventional steels, through to non-ferrous, including the full range of metals, but also ceramics and polymers and composites. So we are largely technology agnostic and materials agnostic. And further to that, we need to be able to inspect and understand the integrity of a structure once it's been made and how that may progress through its lifetime. So what we deliver to industry is both day-to-day advice, but more significantly in this context, addressing strategic challenges. So we run a series of technical webinars. We run a core research program. We also run joint industry projects, which is largely the subject of what we're heading towards around the concept that we'll be discussing today. We also run individual projects dedicated for specific member companies when they have a particular need. I can no longer see...
apologies about that. Just one second. These things happen, unfortunately.
Yeah, that's IT for you. Great. Can you go back one, please? And again. Right, next. Yeah, so that's where we were. Next, please. So we've been innovating since our inception. We've been developing new technologies in response to new industrial challenges. Everything from understanding materials behavior and failure, so fracture, was an early area of work for us. It's actually part of our origins, through to developing new types of joining process, new types of inspection process. And we've been doing that partly through direct investment through industry and then achieving gearing on that with public funding where appropriate. So in total, we've invested more than 500 million in the past 5 years on research and development projects. So today we're focused more perhaps on our on the production and operation end, which tends to have a focus on safety, quality and performance in a very challenging environment. So it's about high integrity structures and how to make those assets, how those assets are used, and then what happens at end of life. Is it possible to reuse or do they need to be decommissioned? So we're working through the lifespan of high value assets. So we've got a long history with hydrogen. That's because hydrogen embrittlement in carbon manganese steels was identified early as one of the major challenges with welds. Hydrogen embrittlement during welding was identified as early as the late 1940s, actually, and we worked actively on it through the 1950s onwards. So that's given us a good baseline understanding of how hydrogen behaves and how to test in a hydrogen environment. So although today we're really talking about non-metallics, the baseline knowledge of how to set up test facilities and how to understand what happens when hydrogen interacts with materials, and critically, having the infrastructure which can handle relatively large components safely in a hydrogen environment is a key part of our work. So what's shown on the screen is a relatively high temperature test rig that can go up to 175 bar, and we can do destructive testing in situ. We can also run full range of mechanical testing. So that's everything from tensile to fatigue across a full range of standards. So we're well set up to undertake hydrogen testing work. And finally, in terms of our hydrogen activities, we operate a lot of diffusion-based work, which is probably an area that there'll be more discussion of in a bit. But the ability to either pre-charge or to measure permeation, and in both situations to understand how hydrogen is behaving or how a material is behaving in exposure to hydrogen, how it's penetrating through different layers, and what acts as an effective barrier and what doesn't in terms not just of materials but of structures is a key component of the hydrogen work that we do. So that's a very brief introduction to what TWI is and what we do. So I'd like to hand over to George to talk specifically about the hydrogen challenge that we're addressing here. Thank you.
Thank you, Alec. So good morning, good evening, or good afternoon, depending on where you're joining us from. Today's webinar is going to focus on some of the work that we've been doing specifically for the hydrogen economy. And over the past few years, we've been working on the development of certain guidelines. Now, this is a webinar that is a joint industry project pre-launch. This is to inaugurate our invitation to launch this joint industry project that will be focused on developing guidelines for testing thermoplastic materials compatibility for high pressure hydrogen service. Now, again, this is a mouthful, but it is required, as we will explain in a few moments. Now, to provide a presentation overview, we'll go through a number of subjects. It may be the case that we go through some of the slides quite quickly. No need to be alarmed. The presentation package will be sent to you after the end of this meeting. So some of the information that has been put in is for your reference and benefit, but not as relevant to our subject nowadays. Mainly, we will have some values and some useful information if you're interested to learn more about the hydrogen economy. But for all intents, we have the following main areas. We'll start with some introductory remarks on the hydrogen economy, the opportunities of this emerging market, challenges that are associated, the route for the transition to a hydrogen economy, designing considerations to implement this transition, and of course, finally, the industry's trends and needs, and a few remarks on this hydrogen GIP. Now, we could summarize the main aspects of a hydrogen economy in the following schematic. Even though it seems simplified, these are the key aspects of a hydrogen economy. After production, we have packing, and this is basically the conversion or the potential conversion to other forms, whether it's compressed hydrogen, liquefied gas, or other organic carriers. The storage and, of course, distribution, which can be done using different mediums and different routes. And finally, the employment of hydrogen. And this is not just for energy. It is also for the production of chemicals and steel reforming and other applications. Now, these are the overall sources for hydrogen production, but for your information, the most popular one are water electrolysis, especially for low carbon hydrogen or green hydrogen, as we will refer to afterwards. The hydrogen which is produced from natural gas reforming and coal gasification. We will mention the colors of these three forms. So water electrolysis is produced through we have green hydrogen primarily from water electrolysis. We have black hydrogen from coal gasification, and either gray or blue hydrogen from natural gas reforming. So we have all the colors here. The basic colors that you need to bear in mind is green, gray, or blue, which essentially are the same thing. The only difference is that with blue, we have carbon capture and storage. And finally, we have brown, which is from black coal reforming. So this is a very emerging market. Green hydrogen is predicted to play a significant role in emission reduction, and of course, the decarbonization of heavy industries. And in this respect, there are many opportunities in this area, many opportunities for investment and general growth. To provide some context, you can see that it is projected that 2/3 of the global hydrogen production will be green by 2050. Now, green hydrogen is associated with significant challenges and costs, and that prediction alone is quite important. There is an obvious demand in reducing the carbon footprint, therefore it is projected that we will see an increase in this low carbon hydrogen, or otherwise green hydrogen or blue hydrogen. And of course, we will see the deployment and decarbonization being applied in a number of countries, since this is also it offers a number of financial and strategic incentives. And this is very well understood nowadays with the turbulence we see in many regions, the increase in energy prices, and of course, the impacts of the war in Ukraine. Net zero scenarios will see the use of hydrogen to be prioritized, and we are at this point where we need to search for other carbon sensitive alternatives. So low emission hydrogen production, as we mentioned, is expected to reach around 38 million tons in 2030. This is showing a 50% increase compared to what we have today. And to give you some context, global hydrogen production reached 95 million tons in 2022, seeing a 3% increase from 2021. So it's quite a huge steep. And the predictions is that this global hydrogen production will increase to 600 to 660 million tons by 2050. These are huge figures. And this is supposed to abate more than 20% of the global CO2 emissions. Now, we mentioned that in 2022, we had about a demand of 95 million tons. And you can see that this is quite a significant increase from the 87 million tons that were required in 2020. However, we have challenges. You can see them as challenges or opportunities for further growth. And these are primarily associated with the development of standards to cover this transition and to allow to provide the necessary confidence for this transition in terms of safety and reliability. So there are some risks and barriers involved in this area, and they're not just related to the safety of the whole of this transition. You can see the nice example of the Hindenburg explosion. Every time we talk about hydrogen, some, especially senior members, think about this event, but it's not just safety issues. It's issues and challenges related to the cost competitiveness, logistical challenges, the fact that there is a gap in regulations and primarily certification and standards in this area. So just to provide just a few remarks on the primary incidents associated with hydrogen. At the moment, we have that we can see that 46% of those incidences are associated with explosion. The effect of hydrogen on metals has been very well understood. However, the effect of hydrogen on polymeric and in particular thermoplastic materials is not that well understood. We're just seeing reports and analysis being launched recently, and further work needs to be carried out in this area and in this respect. So part of the challenges are, as we mentioned, associated to cost, and even safety issues will impact cost. As you can see here, green hydrogen is associated with, it requires a significant production price. And when you compare it to black hydrogen, it doesn't seem as sustainable with a greater sense. But the on the plus side and on the optimistic side, we see that the cost to purchase a water electrolyzer in 2022 to generate green hydrogen ranges from 500 to 5,000 kilowatts dollars per kilowatt, and this is predicted to decrease significantly, and it has decreased. I mean, from since 2010. The cost of an electrolyzer has decreased by 60 to 88%. And there is additional work in this area to further reduce the cost of electrolyzers and other basic equipment for the production of green hydrogen. However, to transition, and being realistic, to transition to a hydrogen economy, it will require the significant contribution and utilization of blue hydrogen. And that is hydrogen from natural gas reforming and a parallel carbon capture and storage, hence the markup price. We can see here the costs associated with hydrogen production, and you can see that depending on what kind of medium you use to transport it, this will have a different cost increase. You can see that compression leads to a cost increase between $1 to $1.5 per kilo. And of course, liquefaction, it will see a much larger increase, not just in cost, but also in safety requirements and material requirements. Ammonia is emerging as a key player in this area, especially for transportation of hydrogen in long distances. But there are also other challenges as well. For example, it will require the allocation. I mean, the transition to hydrogen economy will require an allocation of large land surfaces, and this is against the UN directives for sustainability. So, still, it's something that needs to be worked on. Now, despite the medium, we also see a cost dependency on the transportation type. So the carrier type plays a role, the transportation route and infrastructure plays a role, whether you're going to be using trucks or pipelines, it will have an impact on the actual price. Truck transportation is rather expensive. You can see that a sensible route would be to remediate and repurpose the existing natural gas pipeline, but this will require a significant capital investment. To develop a hydrogen-specific pipeline, it will require an expenditure of, it will require basically double, and actually more than double the price of a natural gas pipeline, and to repurpose the existing pipeline, we will need at least 10 to 25% of a cost increase compared to the natural gas pipeline. So this is a very useful graph. We can see here the different forms of hydrogen carriers. We have liquid organic hydrogen carriers, which is, we can see different variations in this area. We have ammonia, we have liquefied hydrogen, and of course, compressed hydrogen. And you can see that the liquefied hydrogen is basically seeing the largest cost for transportation. It requires significant energy for its conversion. It requires significant costs for its transportation, and of course, its storage. The most competitive route would be with the transportation of hydrogen as compressed hydrogen gas. And of course, we will see that depending on the distance and of course the route for transportation, different options are best. Specifically, depending on the medium. Volumes do play a role. So if you have larger volumes that need to be transferred over short distances, compressed hydrogen gas is the way to go. But however, if you are to do transcontinental transfers of hydrogen, ammonia seems to be the key player for this. We also see that the transportation method varies, and different transportation methods make sense depending on distance. And again, we see that ships can be used only for transfers, of course, 3,000 kilometers, simply because it's not cost effective to produce a pipeline for that. But for let's say the transportation and distribution of hydrogen within continents, a pipeline probably makes best sense. We can see here that for the short-term deployment of hydrogen, we will need to, we have three basic routes, either building a dedicated hydrogen infrastructure, blending hydrogen with natural gas, and this is something that is already being practiced in many regions, and has been for quite some time in certain areas in the U.S., and of course, the third option is to repurpose the existing natural gas grid. The final recommendation is more likely, and we see some efforts in this area, but we need to plan ahead and allow the time in between to develop a actual hydrogen gas network with certified materials that fit the purpose. You can see here that there is some movement in the repurposing of the natural gas network, and there have been investments and set targets by the European Union and the United Kingdom and, of course, the UK and other countries. Feel free to check the links below for more information in this area. However, we must bear in mind that transitioning to a hydrogen economy comes with challenges, and we talked about the cost challenges and safety issues with hydrogen. However, there are certain material challenges, and this is basically due to the effect of hydrogen. We know that hydrogen causes embrittlement for steel alloys. However, with polymers, since we have different polymer types used in different areas, whether this is a joint, valve, or the pipe itself. We have different leakages, different rates, and leakage can be translated to potentially it could increase the risk of explosion, and therefore needs to be managed. So there are many areas and many items that one needs to address and double check before suggesting proposing for a hydrogen pipeline network. So. We're going to look at the designing criteria in a few moments, but just to give you an idea of some of the elements involved in hydrogen transportation. After production, for the transportation, we will need valves. We will need large-scale tanks, and this is not just for storage. This is also for transportation purposes as well. Tanks have different requirements than the transportation system, which is a pipeline network. And of course, for distribution, we'll have filling stations that will have other components as well for either monitoring and of course, utilization and control. So it's not straightforward. Not just one material is involved. This it requires a combination of materials, and we have summarized some of the materials here, so you can see that. Currently, we have HDPE and polyamide being used in hydrogen pressure vessels. This is a new type of vessel. We have three other types that have been used, but this is something more sustainable, something that industry wants to work on, And this will allow basically hydrogen to be a cost-effective route for energy supply. We have other materials used in piping, but of course we see that for sealing, PTFE and PEEK are the winners. And of course we have some other materials depending on the components that are suggested. Now, materials in hydrogen distribution network will see high pressures, of course, and these pressures can reach up to 15,000 PSI. This is, of course, for liquefied hydrogen. Normally, the pressures are between 5,000 to 10,000 for compressed hydrogen, liquefied hydrogen, and for compressed hydrogen, they're lower than that. But we must plan for extreme pressures such as that, specifically for due to the impact of rapid gas decompression, which does occur during the shutdown of certain pipelines. And therefore, this needs to be added into our designing criteria. Temperatures will range from -70 to 120. And of course, this involves a number of cycles, whether this is pressure and temperature. So these are some of the aspects that we took into consideration during our previous assessments prior to launching this GIP and setting some criteria. Now, there are designing gaps and barriers. And the most important one is currently there's not enough on standards and specifications for hydrogen transportation. We have standards and specifications for components that have been used where hydrogen has been used, but for a pipeline and distribution network, there is a significant gap in this area. And these are one of the subjects that we would like to address. We have assessment on shortlisted polymer materials. However, we lack the confidence and guidelines for that will provide the confidence for the use of these polymers in a hydrogen pipeline network. You can see here that there are many mechanisms of degradation in a hydrogen environment. And the combination of these elements and conditions only increases the difficulty in one's assessment, since this is a combined mechanism that involves high pressure and thermal and stress cycles, as well as UV and other weathering exposure conditions, and of course, the chemical interaction in any environment. It's not just hydrogen, it's also the surrounding environment that may have moisture, may have other chemicals involved, simply because we're talking about a distribution over a vast network. Now, there are a number of factors that will affect hydrogen permeation. Now, permeation is important because if there is a chemical effect in the degradation, the interaction of hydrogen along with maybe other chemicals and temperature could lead to the disturbance of the polymer's microstructure. And the disturbance in the polymer's microstructure will lead, of course, to a decline in its mechanical properties. This is very important, especially for high pressure storage tanks, as this could lead to rapid crack growth or immediate burst of the component with a subsequent explosion and other ill effects. We see that the transportation, hydrogen transportation properties within a vessel or within the polymer itself depend on a number of items, and these includes permeability, diffusivity, solubility of the hydrogen or liquid organic hydrogen carrier with the polymer itself, as well as secondary interactions. You may find useful notes in this area if you click on the link and the information provided by Sandia Lab. But in general, it's quite a complex mechanism. There have been some recommended approaches on how to assess this, but all in all, it is still it still requires a further definition. We see also some paradoxes. For example, in some of the work carried out by Klopfer et al., although the crystallinity of polyethylene is much higher than polyamide, the barrier properties of the polymer itself, of polyamide that is, were greater. And this was simply because of the secondary interactions. And this is where we see how secondary interactions can play a vital role, because of the fact that polyamide will form hydrogen bonds. This led to a smaller permeation and diffusion of the hydrogen gas. So not always do we see high crystallinity as the best option. The interaction could lead to certain plasticization effects, which will or could impact the mechanical properties. So again, the fact that you have better barrier properties does not necessarily mean that this is the right polymer to use in the hydrogen transportation network. Now, to discuss about a few things about the industry needs and trends, there is a definite will for the transition to renewable energy sources. This is a strategic decision, and primarily it offers storage option from renewable energy methods. So, for example, where do we store the energy obtained from solar energy or wind turbines? It offers that safety net and buffer zone for the times that you cannot have production through these renewable sources. This offers some confidence, some reliability on renewable energy sources, and does not require replenishing or using fossil fuels in between. And of course, it gives you flexibility over the power system. In our day and age, it's rather important. Industry will have high demands in hydrogen, and this is not a new thing. It has been used in refining. It is used, and we have an annual requirement and demand of 40 million tons. This may increase with the increase in refined chemicals. It has been used in the chemical industry for the production primarily of ammonia and methanol, which are basic components in everyday chemical applications. It has been used in steel reforming and steel production, this could lead to basically the decarbonization of this heavy industry. And to lesser extents, it's required in other industries as well. So being able to provide a low carbon hydrogen source is important, and definitely further investment in the hydrogen economy could allow for rendering these markets and these industries more sustainable. Now, we mentioned before that there is a lack of international standards and regulations. And this is one of the key areas where we're trying to make some contributions, in particular through this GIP. There is ambiguity on what is required for clean and reliable hydrogen. And also there is a lack of regulations to protect both the producers of hydrogen, but also the users and employee and the handler safety. So these things need to be covered. Further work is required, not just for the material, the material accreditation, but also for the certification of the hydrogen based on type, as well as its conversion afterwards. There are some available standards that cover hydrogen testing. However, this is not in particular for the selection of polymeric materials to be used in hydrogen services. This could demonstrate compatibility and just recommend some tests, but a global unified standard for the use of polymers in hydrogen transportation vessels and pipelines is not there yet. Closing the presentation, and I'm happy to say within the time limit, we're launching this webinar to inaugurate our GIP. Now, this joint industry project has certain objectives, and the main objectives are, of course, to benchmark a selected some selected polymers that have been identified through a qualification process based on two projects that were funded by TWI's core research program. This was done in conjunction with the support of our industrial members and technical experts provided from those members, and with the ultimate goal to provide a best practice guidance document that will provide that confidence for material selection and of course for the designing criteria to develop a hydrogen pipeline and storage system. It is, of course, within the sponsors, our members' discretion to see if we could share our findings with standardization bodies and hopefully contribute in the development of a globally recognized standard for the adaptation of polymeric materials in the hydrogen economy. The approach of the GIP, as we mentioned, was based on the findings of two prior projects, which of course involved the selection and characterization of certain polymeric materials and the testing conditions and types, and of course the approach was to see what the effects of hydrogen under an array of conditions and environments and a range of surface temperatures and pressures, as well as humidity and weather conditions, what the effect was on those materials, and of course the aim of these efforts was to provide confidence over the selected materials and of course the service conditions and of course fitness for service after the desired life cycle of the material. The work plan through the GIP is designed to be covered over two phases. First one is the material and testing data survey. This will include some testing of the already identified polymeric materials. And finally, once this is covered, the development of the guidelines for the testing of the polymeric materials in hydrogen service. If you wish to contact us to learn more either about our GIP program or other areas similar to this where TWI is contributing in the GIP network, please feel free to reach out. You could also ponder on being a member and see what are the benefits provided by TWI's membership program. And of course, for any other inquiry on polymers, et cetera, feel free to reach out. And with this, we can start the panel discussion by answering certain questions. Sophia, over to you in your moderation.
Thank you, George. First of all, thank you for the very interesting presentation. Just to mention to all the attendees, we have seen that you have typed in some questions. We will proceed now to the panel discussion, and then depending on the time remaining, we will try to cover some of the questions. If we don't manage to cover all of them, we will come back to you with the relevant answers. And of course, if there are more questions, please keep typing them in, and we will come back to you with this information. So with regards to the panel discussion, we are very happy to have with us today Dr. Konstantinos Vantopoulos. He's a manager of the Non-Metallic Research Center of Saudi Aramco Technologies. And we also have Dr. Azadin Kuhl, who is a chief scientist at SABIC Chemical Manufacturing Company. The idea is that we are going to receive some questions from both of them in order to assist more the understanding towards the discussion and the presentation that George gave today. So, Kostas, Azadin, over to both of you.
Thank you very much, Sophia, and thank you very much, George, for a very interesting presentation. A question I have for you, George, is you're proposing here a framework, and I was wondering, how do you see this supporting pipe manufacturers in accelerating the process for hydrogen prior to adoption of the field, because we know that this qualification takes time, and introducing new materials and with the polymeric materials having a very wide range, let's say, of properties, it might lead to a long qualification time, while we need, I would say, solutions yesterday.
Despite the obvious challenge here and the knowledge of from industry on how long this qualification program takes, and of course the large investment, there is still a great interest in this area, and we see pipe manufacturers and other industries as well as resin manufacturers heavily investing in this area, either through the recommendation and development of new materials, but also projects such as the ones mentioned in evaluating these properties. There are many polymeric materials that can be used. The qualification program requires certain steps, which of course take a significant amount of time, but this is not an area, let's say, that is strange to us. TWI has innovation centers and partnerships that have expertise in this area. Most notably is the Non-Metallic Innovation Center, where we have carried out similar qualification programs. The steps, of course, towards this qualification program are defined through certain standards, and similar practices could be applied. You know, following those standards, one could start with by applying the designing criteria and enriching those designing criteria to address certain concerns or requirements of the of hydrogen transportation, but definitely this is something that we do see movement despite the long journey. It's something that companies and producers are interested in, and we see the movement in this area. Of course, it does require joint industry projects such as the one that we are launching now, where we can have the contribution of different industrial players to make either recommendations or highlight areas of concern, as well as aspects of service conditions and production requirements. These are very useful to be included in the designing criteria, so that we do not have any devastating surprises or failures after huge investments in the whole designing process.
Thank you, George.
Next question. Over to you. Can you hear as well? Yeah.
Yeah. Hi, Azadin. Thanks, Sofia, and thanks, George, for the talk. I think you mentioned a few points which are really relevant. Not understood the interaction between polymers and hydrogen. This is a very, very important point. So I have noted that, and we know that this is very important. So I think room, George, now as a polymer supplier, any room for materials development or production, getting new resins. What is your view? For any application, does it mean that for this application we need a new neat resin? But can we use the existing resins? Then we move to a modified resin, and then we take it from there. So what is your view on that?
Well, definitely there are some polymeric materials that have been shortlisted, and this is based on either testing data and the confidence and reliability associated with that data. But definitely there is a lot of room for improvement, and this is not just because of the new emerging market of the hydrogen economy, but this is a practice that we see resin manufacturers applying for existing, let's say, for example, in oil and gas. We see the continuous improvement of these resins to improve the properties And expand the operating windows of these networks. So definitely there's much room for improvement, simply because there are so many elements, and the merge of these elements and materials in a hydrogen pipeline requires knowledge and testing over time. Just to give some context, we have different polymer grades that have been suggested to be used in the hydrogen infrastructure. And this includes high-density polyethylene, polyamides, polyphenylene sulfides. And for sealants, we see for valves and flanges, we see that primarily we have the use of Teflon, PEEK, acetal. In some cases, they're evaluating norbornene and Viton for sealing materials. But the merge of these materials with the carriers can, of course, or there is always room for improvement in this aspect. We also see movements in changing the architecture of existing polymers, the network of existing polymers, simply because the impact of hydrogen on these materials is something that we're just starting to understand. There are many suggestions and many recommendations and many hypotheses on the, for example, the damage mechanism. In particular, there's one hypothesis that the damage mechanism is time dependent and is linked to hydrogen outgassing. This, of course, makes ex situ measurements of mechanical properties quite difficult and challenging. So we have studies in this area. We also have studies looking at the long-term effect of the interaction of hydrogen, not so much as chemical, but the physical interaction, how it may act as a plasticizer and how it may lead to changes in the microstructure. And this, of course, for a polymer scientist is an area where remediation and certain improvements can be applied, either through different co-monomer applications or the evaluation of the branching effect for long-term resistance against failure can be applied. So the fact that we have some selected materials does not restrict or limit the development of new materials, and this could include material blends or functionalized thermoplastics. So as the resin manufacturer and polymer industry grows and has been continued to grow throughout these last few decades, we will see the introduction, I believe, of new polymer resins and the continuous R&D to improve the conditions and of course the operating envelope of the hydrogen pipeline network.
Thanks, George.
Any other questions, Sophia?
I don't know if Kostas has any other question before we go onto the open questions.
Looking at the time, Sophia, I was wondering, George, if you could shed some light with regards to whether this qualification or testing procedure that you will be proposing is it going to be focusing on the liner materials or on the polymer material and their performance, or are you looking at the component with the reinforcement as a system? You're presenting as a system, so a whole pipe, a whole tank, or something like that.
For the time being, we're looking at the first line of defense, and that is the liner material. Simply because if the liner material fails, then you can better assess the impact that will have to the reinforcement layers or other layers. So I think over 50% of the work in the designing process is the evaluation of the liner material, the impact of hydrogen that the hydrogen has on that material. And secondly, we can assess the the performance of the either the vessel or the pipe system as a whole. So for the time being, we're focused on the liner material. This includes certain strength, ductility, and fatigue resistant tests, and the tensile and bending properties, the usual work that one would imagine in any development framework.
Understood, sort of a pre-qualification to support the large scale qualification that all manufacturers do at the pipe level testing. Exactly. Now that's
prior cool. to that investment to a few meters of pipe, whether it's reinforced or any other type.
Thank you very much. Being mindful of the time, I think, because we have only 4 minutes now remaining, we are going to pick up one from the questions at the moment, which is in the Q&A. We have several of them, but I think we could answer one which is material connected. So this comes from Claudine Hijadi. And the question is, if we see PA6 as a possible material to be used for vessels, and if we have any comments in terms of how it is compared to PA11?
This depends, of course, on the specific grade. I know that PA6 and PA11 have different variations. I'm reluctant to answer because this would basically disclose some of the data that we've obtained through our core research program, and this is accessible and for our members. So without revealing too much, I can say that polyamides were in the were one of the selected materials. There are concerns due to the environmental conditions of the use and deployment of this type of grade in a hydrogen pipeline network, and this is not just a matter of cost. The comparison between the two, I would advise if one checks with polyamide suppliers, there's a lot of data in the public domain that suggests which type of the two is best suited for hydrogen applications. Now, bear in mind, depending on the application, it may be the case that both grades are used, whether this is a fuel cell or a distribution network, you will have different requirements. So that is also an additional factor that one needs to bear in mind. But PA11 is definitely seeing more attraction.
Thank you, George. So I think it's a good time to start closing this webinar. Before moving to the end, I will quickly mention, because I saw a question on the Q&A with regards to whether we have a dedicated website about this project where you can find information around that. I would like to mention that there is already a page which has been uploaded on TWI's website, which we can share with you as well to keep that as a reference with regards to the project. This web page includes information about the objectives that George mentioned before, and also the anticipated activities that will be part of the work plan of this JIP joint industry project. So in order to close for today, first of all, I would like to, and we would like to thank you all for attending this webinar. Special thanks to our panelists, Kostas and Azadin. Many thanks for the valuable questions today. Also, thanks to Alec and George for the presentation. We believe that this topic is an interesting one to allow us to go to the development of this joint industry project and to a launch meeting where we will have the opportunity to discuss with potential sponsors the activities of this project, the anticipated duration, and also to define the work plan in the best possible way, depending on the interests of the sponsors. Thank you very much all for your time. Have a nice rest of your day.
Thank you, Sophia. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, George.
Thank you very much. Bye.